we talked about the process that we use here at the personal coach. And I'd just like to take a minute to talk a little bit around how we do coaching, for anyone who might have an interest. First of all, we do one-on-one. It's all customized one-on-one coaching. We do it face-to-face. We do it with notes. So after every meeting, we say, okay, let's identify what are the to-dos. And then my job is to hold people's feet to the fire, make sure that they get those to-dos done so that they're taking it to the next level. We follow up by a phone call, and when people get stuck, they phone us or email us, and so that we can always have constant communication. So I feel like I've got my sleeves rolled up, and I'm working with a client side by side to help them make the changes they need to make to move on to their new S-curve. Things that make us unique. Pretty well every office that I go into, I can tell you who all the staff members are. So I know some of those staff members almost as well as the advisor does, and I think that helps in terms of providing leverage. The follow-up notes I think are important, agenda, et cetera. And then here's one that I think is really important. That sometimes, and this doesn't apply to everybody, but I find sometimes if it isn't perfect, they're never happy. The problem is you're never going to get perfection. And so what we like to do is we don't want to get in the gap here. So here's the starting point. Here's the ideal goal. And everyone's kind of hit towards that. But we want to measure against what is the actual accomplishment. Because this ideal goal, for some reason or other, seems to keep moving on us all the time. You never get to perfection. So you don't want to be in the gap. You want to be, are we making progress? And I found over my business career, if I'm making progress, over a period of time, you tend to build great businesses. And those million-dollar businesses, with, by the way, I might also add, good balanced lifestyle. I was on the phone with one of my clients' wives who had kind of given his spouse, the advisor, an ultimatum. Said, you know what, we got a young family, I need you home here on the weekends, I need you to be part of it. And so part of the pact we kind of made together was, look, we're going to work together to make sure that we have a balanced lifestyle. It's not all about work, it's about building a great life, which includes your business life and your personal life. And so I phoned her a couple weeks ago just to get a little bit of report card of how we were doing. And she said, it's not perfect, but we've certainly made a lot of progress. And that's all I wanted to hear. I want to hear progress. And so that's really important. So, you know, if it's good for you, it's good for us. This is what our ideal client looks like. They're an established advisor associated with one. They've got a minimum revenue of around $250,000. They have one assistant. They want to grow, feeling overwhelmed. They're diffused. They feel like they're more reactive than proactive. You know, those million-dollar businesses, they're all very proactive. The business isn't driving them. They're driving the businesses. If anyone's been on our website, there's a quote on there from Barry Fowler. Barry Fowler took over his dad's business. He was actually the very first client of the personal coach. And I didn't realize it initially at the time, but the business was driving Barry instead of Barry driving the business. And he's very eloquent in his comments around that. Difficulty implementing, would like to simplify things, wants more freedom, money freedom or time freedom, has a strong level of attention to affect change and willing to act on it, coachable, and likes chocolate. We find everyone likes, all of our clients, they like chocolate. And in fact, one of our little branding items, a little thank you we have, I think it's a marketing here. They do customized little chocolate pieces. That's a little thank you from the personal coach, kind of neat. So ties into our brand. And here's some benefits of working for a coach, working with a coach. And I know that Sun Life has some coaching services here too. And so you need to take a look at that. But you get clearer focus, you get smarter actions, challenge your potential. Get a balanced life, identify your sweet spot, better decisions, accountability, more money, more time freedom, sustainable energy and execution, increased confidence, and you know what? You end up liking yourself a lot better. Mm-hmm. Now, if what I've talked to you about today makes some sense for you, and you feel like coaching might be something that you might want to look at, you can go on to the Personal Coach website, and there's a little questionnaire there that will help you to identify whether, in fact, you're ready for coaching. Remember having, and this comes out of, you know, I believe that you develop things based upon your life experiences. So I had this client very early in the personal coach career who I wished we had this tool at the time. Because every time I'd make a suggestion, he said, no, I don't want to do that. I don't want to do that. And at the end of the day, it became obvious to both of us. He wanted to get from here to here, but he didn't want to make any changes. I said, I can't help you. And so this will just help you identify whether, in fact, coaching is for you on any basis. And so if this makes any sense, I encourage you to do that. And I'm here also. You've got an opportunity, if you'd like, a one-hour complimentary. If you complete this questionnaire and give that back to Kelly at the back there, that would be great. And then we'll be in touch in terms of reading that one-hour complimentary session. I thank you for your attention, and I think we're on time. Do we have any extra time?
We have time for a couple of questions if you want.
Yes?
How do you work with the challenge of the fact that not every client wants or needs a plan? For example, they come to you with a very specific need. I need life insurance for this. They might not necessarily be an ideal client, but heck, they paid the bill, which pays your bill. So
yep.
What challenge do you see?
Okay, so that comes back to your relationship management strategy. Yeah. So they wouldn't rate as a top client, would
yes,
they?
Yes, correct.
So let's say they fit into the third tier. So okay. You make sure that you have a strategy that meets their needs.
Yes.
Okay, around touches.
Yeah.
And with them, it might just be see them twice a year, once every 2 years. Maybe you have some kind of a Thanksgiving card out. Touches that keep you in front of them, okay? And that's the key to developing these relationship management strategies, to say, okay, and I find that once people have segmented their client base, it's very easy for them to say, okay, I see what I can do with this client to at least keep them paying those premiums, as you say, paying the bill, while at the same time I'm not knocking myself out to meet their needs.
Now what about for a new acquisition with regards to the plan that your advisor, Perry Sound, had? All they want is their mortgage life or critical illness and insurance. I mean, they're not going to get, they're going to get sped-walked around the, around that.
Well, here's the issue, though. And here's the other thing I think you need to always pay attention to. Again, I'll go back to the cotton planning system. Is it a product sale or is it a planning trail?
Right.
So sometimes with a brand new client who's very focused, like, I just bought a brand new house, I need to get this mortgage looked after. You look after that.
Yes.
It's a product sale.
Yep.
And as you're doing this, of course, you're gathering some more information, and in your mind, you're saying, you know what, this person could be an ideal client. And so then you, after they get settled down, you double back, and you go back and you give them the process.
Yeah.
Okay. And
how quick do you determine if you left one category out, product sale, planning trail?
Garbage bill.
So how do you determine that, and how quickly?
Well, we've all heard this word China egg, I'm sure, and sometimes we sit on those China eggs too long and they never do get hatched at the end of the day. You know, if they're not coachable, if they're not giving you energy, but they got all sorts of potential, might they be a thorn in your side? I'll tell you a story. I have a client who had a client with $1.6 million worth of assets. And they were not coachable. They were nothing but a thorn in my client's side. And we began to give him compliance problems. And so he and I walked this through on the phones. And I said, let me ask you something. Knowing what you know right now, would you really want them as a client? And we talked about that a little bit. He said, you know what? He said, not really. I said, then make it easy for them to move to another advisor. And, of course, what always is happening in the background when you have someone in 1.6 million, there's always someone coaching in the background. And so, as it turns out, this situation, although my client, the advisor, didn't have any compliance issues, the guy in the background was trying to cause something. And I don't know if anybody's ever been in trouble with the MFDA, but you were guilty until you proved yourself innocent. It is the most savage experience that I've had a couple of my clients. clients go through. These are good advisors who have had compliance issues. And so when a client comes in and complains to your dealer, they have to report that to the MFDA within 2 days. And it goes on their bloody website. So if someone's Googling you, that actually can bump on the website. So you've got to stand back, and I know we're all trying to, you know, add new clients, but by golly, if they don't line up either reasonably with your new ideal client profile, and you're not getting respect from them, you're not getting energy, you don't feel like they're coachable, walk away and go on to the next one. I got it?
Awesome.
Okay, thank you very much.